Good afternoon, everyone. We are honored today to have Alexander Gerst joining us for a presentation on the Horizons mission and a Q&A session. Alexander Gerst is an ESA astronaut. He's from Germany, and he's a geophysicist who flew 2 times to the International Space Station, 1 time in the Expedition 4041 back in 2014, and the other time Expedition 5657 back in 2018. We'll start today's session with a short video featuring this last mission of 2018, the Horizons mission, where Alexander Gerst was the commander of the ISS. Then we'll follow with a Q&A session, so please submit your questions and comments in the YouTube chat, and Alexander will be answering them after the video. Enjoy the show!
Alexander Gerst to the International Space Station for a 6-month stay.
Contact confirmed.
And we are back. Thank you, Alexander. This was an amazing video. It was great to watch. And it's really nice to get to see a part from your experience at ISS. Maybe to start before the Q&A session, could you give us some highlights about your mission from your own perspective?
Yeah, thanks, Tatiana. Hi to everybody joining us today. Yeah, it's amazing for me to see that video once in a while. It brings me right back into the International Space Station. Performing all the science experiments that we did up there, 371 different experiments that we performed. And also, of course, a big highlight is the perspective that we get from out there looking down onto our planet. But also, and then that is the tie to your project here, the IGLUNA, is that, of course, ISS is also a test bed for future exploration. We test lots of systems, like environmental systems, like life support systems, new technologies. And that is great to see all those projects that you have developed, because that is really the future of human spaceflight. So I'm very honored to be able to speak to you today, to the new generation of explorers, of space explorers, and I'm looking forward to hearing your questions.
Great, thank you very much. We're very thankful that you have the time to join us today, and that you have you support the IGLUNA student teams. And yes, we're getting some questions, particularly about related to IGLUNA, as you were touching now the topic of life support systems. There were some students that developed systems for this year about greenhouses, bioreactors for waste management. From your experience at ISS, how much improvement do these technologies actually need to be then working on the moon or a Mars colony?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. I think it's probably one of the, or if not the most important question that we need to answer before we can fly to Mars. I've looked at the projects. Actually, there are amazing ones. Some of them I knew before, like the Melissa project is something that I was aware of before. And you might know, we also did testing of the life support rack on my last mission. I actually installed the life support rack, and we had the photo bioreactor coming up there. And of course, I think everybody working with this knows that this is a critical system that we need to improve a lot before we fly to Mars, because with every little percent of more capability that an ecosystem has, of the more closed it is, the less consumables we need to bring up to space. So that alone means, okay, we need to improve. Right now, the water recycling on ISS is already not bad. The numbers are anywhere between like 70 and 90%, depending on how you count. We recycle urine up to a great part, but still we have a lot of waste that we throw away, human waste, food waste that has water in it that we throw out. That is one problem, like the sort of the carbon cycle on board a spaceship. And that is something that we need to improve before we go to Mars. Also, life support systems tend to be so complex that they also are quite intensive in maintenance, meaning we have to take care of them really well and a lot. And if they break, then we're in trouble. So means we need to bring up redundancies, which is also heavy. So any development step forward that we can get on those systems will bring us far ahead. And also that, especially like those biological systems, they sort of get into closing the cycle a bit more. And so that is something that is interesting, because we probably need it in the future, but also they take up a lot of space and mass. So how can we make them smaller and more efficient in the future? That is going to be one of the big questions, and it's good to see that you guys are working on that one, because quite frankly, all the engineers that I knew so far, nobody really has found a solution yet.
Not good to know that there's no solution, but good to know that students have the opportunity actually to work on these systems, and that their work is valuable, hopefully that they will be implemented in the future. So that's exciting.
Yeah, that they chose a good topic. I've come across negative. I don't want to say there is no solution. I'm just saying we're not quite there yet. So right now we could send a spaceship to Mars. We just would have to bring more consumables, which will make it more, well, tricky to launch. So, and we can take less payloads. So it's not something that is a complete showstopper, but the more you guys can work on that, and also we can work on that together, the better the mission will be.
Exactly. Yes, no, that's something good to do, to work. There's an opportunity there for students to actually develop something that will be useful and valuable for future space missions. Actually, staying on this topic about the plants and the life support system, some students in their greenhouses are growing herbs and red chili to enhance the food tasting experience. According to your experience there, was the food tasting different in space? Do you really need these enhancements?
Yeah, it's good to hear that you guys are also not only growing salads, but also herbs and spices and chilies, because I actually think this is really important in general. To me, it's a little hobby as well. I just actually planted some chilies a few weeks ago. I still hope I can grow them on my roof terrace in Cologne. Maybe I can even harvest this year. I'm a little bit late this year growing them, some habanero chilies. And you're touching an important point, because it's not only food nutrition. Food is also soul food, and motivation is going to be a really, really important factor for any crew going into space for such a long time. So you really want to make sure you don't have only food to survive, but also food to look forward to after a long day of work. Adding some spices, adding some interesting tastes to your food is very important for that. We realized that during our missions as well. Your question was, does the sense of taste change? I'm not sure, honestly. I've heard people talk about it, and also speculating that the sense of taste changes in an aircraft, maybe due to the pressure. In space, I didn't notice that. First of all, the pressure was the same on ISS, and I think really my taste buds work just as similar as they do on the ground. What I did notice is that some of my cravings changed, just because some of the stuff I didn't get in such a regular base. Like on Earth, I rarely crave veggies because I get enough of them. And salads, I eat a lot down here, so I don't crave them too much. But as soon as I was in space, I was looking forward to having something fresh. A salad would have been great. So it's more like what you look forward to at the end of the day. That changes, and it's really good to develop systems that can provide us with just a little bit of spice on top, or a little bit of freshness on top of what we eat out of cans. That makes a big difference at the end of the day.
That is really interesting to know, and actually it makes sense. And it's of course important also to keep astronauts happy there, so they are more efficient and they can work better also while they're up there. Actually, we saw you also eating a salad in the video. So the students also, I'm getting here a question from our viewers. Is there already a plant cultivation system that are actively used as a food production on the ISS? Or like this salad was brought from Earth, or it was cultivated there?
No, we grew that salad ourselves. Actually, on both of our missions, we grew salad leaves. On my first mission in 2014, we had sort of the first test bed experiments up there, where we grew salad leaves from little seeds up to the big size salad plants. Back then, we weren't allowed to eat it because scientists still wanted to find out whether it's safe to eat, whether there's maybe bacteria on the surface that would harm us. So we only harvested it, froze it to minus 80, and then brought it back down. Then in my second mission, actually, we had another instance of that experiment. It was called Veggie, where we had a cube about sort of the size of the screen that you have here right now, where we grew salad plants, different types, kale and just like average green salad and different types. And actually we're allowed to eat it in the end. And that was very interesting. To me, it was a totally new sort of sense of taste after having not tasted anything green for a few months. At the same time, it was also weird. It was a weird experience in that there were only so few leaves, and we knew we needed to cherish them. And so I was looking forward to a big bowl of salad with like dressing all over it and this and that. But then in the end, we only had like two or three leaves that everybody could eat. So in a way, that was almost a little bit frustrating at the same time as being refreshing. So I put a little bit of balsamic vinegar droplets on it, and I tasted it. Some of the salad actually tasted bitter, which we didn't enjoy. That was part of the experiment and seeing how it tasted. But what we noticed out of that is, for now, actually, it takes quite a bit of time and effort to, you have to water it every day. The system wasn't automatic, and you have to, like, we had to document it every day. So you could automize all that, which would be great in the future. But the main problem that I see is that it takes a lot of space. On ISS, we do have some space where we can grow a few leaves. But if you really want to produce freshies, veggies in quantities that will be meaningful to the crew, how do you do that with some limited space that you have on a vehicle going to Mars? You would have to come up, and that is probably where we need your ingenuity, all the young engineers, how to make such systems small enough that we can bring them on a small spaceship and still have them produce freshies. That is something that I'm wondering how that will work, and we really need your ideas on that one.
Oh, that's good. You know, we do have some teams working with the light system, so maybe optimizing a bit the growth as well. So hopefully we'll get to see this in a space mission as well. Actually, to follow with this topic, the viewers are asking, what happens after you eat with the human waste? Are they left in space, or are they collected and also experimented on or fed into a closed loop system?
Yeah, right now we don't do anything with it. We just collect it, and then we put it like the space toilet collects it automatically. And we leave them in the containers that they're in, and then they come back, like the solid waste comes back in a spacecraft that is a resupply cargo spacecraft. After we take out the fresh items that the cargo spacecraft brings up, we fill that spacecraft basically with trash, all sorts of trash that we generate, human and then all other trash. And then after undocking those spacecraft, they burn up in the atmosphere because those spacecraft for now are not designed to land. For example, the Cygnus or the Japanese HTV or the Progress, the Russian Progress. So we use them as to get rid of waste so we don't create space debris. But in the future, yeah, if we want to have a really closed life support system, we have to copy Earth, right? And on Earth, nothing is wasted, right? So it's a big cycle, and we have to sort of regenerate that cycle with the goal of getting a 100% closed life support system. Then we will have to make use also of all sorts of trash to extract what we can out of that. So lots of innovation that we need for that. But then again, the question is, can we wait to go to Mars until we find until we build a 100% closed life support system? Certainly not. That wouldn't be a wise idea. I think we should do it at the same time. I think we should plan to go ahead and go to Mars and make use of what we have. And instead of putting all effort into closing those life support systems completely, we should probably put even more effort in making them reliable and small and redundant. That is, in the end, probably more important than closing them up completely.
I agree with that. And I would say, yes, not only maybe to go to Moon or Mars, but I would say that these systems are very useful here on Earth as well to make a sustainable future. So they would also Absolutely. Have here an application.
And also working with it, we learn to appreciate how important Earth is as a life support system. If we disturb that system, we're going to be in a bad situation. So really that has come to my mind, being on a spacecraft, working in a closed sort of small contained environment. It's like, wow, you really appreciate what the resources that you have with you. And that is applicable to that planet beneath you as well.
Indeed, yes. I understand, and I totally agree with that. Going now to your experience, not only the life support aspect, but your overall experience in space, one of our viewers is asking, what is the biggest difficulty when carrying experiments in space?
You mean in general, like when we do experiments in space, what's the biggest difficulty?
I would say yes, how you move. I don't know what would be the difficulty there. Maybe the lack of gravity somehow would interfere.
Yeah, you know, the biggest difficulty is that space is unintuitive. If we design an experiment, usually we like to, as a scientist, I'm a scientist myself, we like to design experiments in a way that we can sort of predict the conditions that the experiment will happen into. And the only thing that we cannot predict, because otherwise there wouldn't be a point in making the experiment, is the result. In space, it's a little bit more difficult because the space is such a weird environment that lots of things in our experiment might behave differently as it's designed to. And in the end, a lot of experiments actually come up with a completely different result than we expected. And also, like, they sort of tend to sometimes go off in directions that we cannot predict. The good thing is that way you discover a lot more new things. You don't only discover the things that you want to discover because you predicted it, but also, like, I mean, for example, we found a new type of a cold flame in a combustion experiment that was designed to look at hot flames, and then realized, wow, there's a second mode that this flame can burn in. And wow, the scientists never saw that before on Earth. And all of a sudden, they were like going off in all directions, thinking, wow, we can make use of this flame to maybe build cleaner engines on Earth, and something that nobody has foreseen at all. And that is amazing because it's a difficulty and an opportunity at the same time. So to me, I always enjoyed those experiments. And we had several that we sort of had to bring back on track with human interaction and sort of a bit of a MacGyver approach to fixing things, just because things behave differently as predictable.
That sounds actually really like a lot of fun, and to be learning things on the way, that's really good to increase our knowledge as well. There's also questions now related to your experience. What was the best meal you had while you were up there?
Oh, the best meal is usually fresh things, like when the Russians send up their Progress vehicles or Cygnus or SpaceX comes up. We usually got right on top of the vehicle after opening the hatch a few fresh things. And that was always really well received by the crew. You'd think, of course, that must be all like fruit and apples and oranges. But some of those things actually were too intense for me. That was funny. I opening a bag of apples almost like knocked me out. Like the sensation, the intensity of the sensation was so strong that it was actually too much for me. So one of the things we all like for some weird reason is like citrus fruits, like oranges or grapefruits actually are even better. And they last a long time in zero-G, so you can keep them for weeks. Those were great meals. And then I had some meals that were made, like some German type meals or international meals that were made by ESA in cooperation with an airplane food provider. They sent them up. I had like butter chicken and German style noodles and things that I could share with my crewmates. I really enjoyed those.
Oh, that sounds really like a great experience, also international experience.
That we all enjoyed is we did self-made sort of makeshift burgers that we created from tortillas that we had sometimes in our food and some dehydrated burger patties. And then we added, actually once we added some salad when we harvested it. That was a rare event. And like condiments and sort of, it takes a lot of time to build those things in weightlessness because things tend to fly away and this and that. But on a Friday evening, when you sit together with the crew, float together with the crew, you have some time, and then it's actually fun to celebrate some food goodies like that. And you just like, it takes an hour to make it and eat it, but you really enjoy it.
Yeah, it's part of the living together, but also experiencing these things together, I guess, to strengthen as well the crew up there. So that's really nice. You have the opportunity to do these type of things. And going more into your space experience, they were also noticing, one of our viewers, that you were photographing while you were up there. And they are asking, what is the most amazing view or photo you got to see from space?
Yeah, well, the overall answer is easy. That is Earth. Indeed, I think I took about 400,000 photos on my first mission and about 500,000 on my second mission, because I also did a lot of time lapses, meaning I set up the camera to take a photo every second or so. You saw some of them in the video before. And then if you stitch it together to make a time lapse, you get this amazing 4K video of the Earth beneath you. I really enjoyed that. That was sort of my hobby. And I noticed that, I mean, even if I spent a year in space, that was a combined time of my both my missions, Earth every day looked differently. Like you come across the same point over Earth a lot. Basically, every day you cross a certain point once between 52 north and 52 degrees south. So you get to know that place really well. I mean, I really feel like that planet I know really well now. But those places look different every single day. So you can make amazing photos one day, and then it's a gray day the next day. So weather is also visible and impacts you from above. And that way it never got boring. I could always spend as much time as I needed looking out the window. And in fact, sometimes I had to force myself to not take photos. And that was hard, because usually after like 3.5 minutes of forcing myself to not take photos and just to enjoy the view, I saw something that I knew I had to share, because this was something new that I hadn't seen before. And I really, I almost never managed to leave my hands off the cameras. And in the end, I always snapped some photos, and I ended up putting it on Twitter or so, and just sharing it with you guys down here, just because it was so important for me. As it was like a relief valve to make sure you guys are up there with me.
Yeah, well, it was great that you did that, because that way we got to enjoy your fantastic view as well. So it's really nice of you that you shared with us down here. And yes, I mean, we still have the picture, so at least we can try to imagine how it is to be up there and dream about it. So that's really nice. Talking about your experience in ISS, besides taking photographs and that you enjoy that, what would be something else that you would have to like? Maybe that there it was not there. They were saying, what thing you would like to have on ISS to improve your life up there?
Actually, ISS is a luxury place. It's such a great large space station. It's up there since 20 years. We really have everything that we need up there. I mean, and I could bring a few things personal, but they're not really necessary anyways, because like our space agencies take care so well of us. So really, to me, it's the opposite question is actually a more important is, what can we sort of cut away from all that? What would we, of what we have on ISS, what is essential for us to travel further into space? Which of those things do we need to bring to Mars to stay healthy as a crew? And I know, I think partly the answer already you could probably sense from what I said before is, one of the things that we humans need is motivation. If we fly to Mars, also if we live on the moon for a while, for a long time, we need motivation to keep going, to endure those hardships that are undoubtedly there. And that means we need to be inspired by our surroundings. We need to be stimulated by our surroundings. And therefore, I think one of the most important things is a window. If we build a habitat, or not a habitat, a stationary one, but a module going to Mars, I think one of the most important things for us is a window that allows us to look at Earth as it gets smaller and smaller. In the end, eventually being a small, faint, almost not visible blue little dot on the sky. Also on the way to Mars, it will disappear behind the sun. So at some stage, we won't be able to see Earth. And that will be an amazing experience mentally for philosophically for us humans, a perspective that the astronauts going to Mars will have to transport back. And that you can only do with the window. That's why that will be a very important thing, because otherwise, how do you share all that experience and at the same time, you probably need a window on the other side that shows Mars getting larger and larger, the new world that we're heading for. And the first humans to ever travel there, it must be amazing to see that getting larger every day. So to me, if I have to choose one thing that I really need on the way to Mars is that perspective, to see it with my own eyes. And I guess we talked about the food, that is also going to be important in a way to have that. And everything else you can deal with, I'm pretty sure. Everything else, we're humans, are very flexible. I noticed that we can adapt to almost any conditions. If a few boundary conditions are met.
That's true. I mean, well, we have to see for these long trips to Mars that maybe they don't return, but for at least for the moon and for ISS, when people come back, maybe that changes also the mindset of the duration of the mission. But talking
but
about this human
exploration, you know, to come back, I think it's an important thing. I think, of course, there will always be humans who decide, hey, I like it here. I'm gonna stay. But definitely, it's part of exploration to go somewhere, to experience it as a human, to feel, to see, and then to come back and to share. That's our firm belief at ESA.
Yes. That's an important thing, I think. But well, other aspects, I'm just trying to read here the questions, many comments here from the viewers. Many questions are very curious to follow on this human well-being aspect. Someone is asking, don't you miss the natural sounds like birds and the rain, the interaction between humans and animals and plants? If maybe like recording of these sounds would be helpful to keep astronauts happy.
Yeah, again, a good point. Of course, we all miss those things. That is very clear. I miss those in space. About the recordings, I think that's probably very individual. Some people, I think, have used them and they found them interesting. To me, it doesn't do much. I tried it. But then again, I found that it's not so much of a problem for me to miss all those things for a while. And that brings me back to what I just said before is, to me, it's a big difference if I know, hey, for a certain number of months, I'm going to miss all those things. That's not a big deal. It could also be 3 years. That's not a big deal. I'm happy to it because I'm on such an interesting mission. I'm so inspired by what I'm doing. This is really cool to be up here. I don't care if I miss a few things in the meantime, or maybe I do care, but it's not going to be a showstopper for me. But knowing if I put myself into somebody's shoes who knows, hey, I'm leaving this behind forever. I'm never going to come back. I'm never going to hear the rustling of the leaves in the wind or the drops of rain on the ceiling of a camping tent, or the waves breaking on a beach. That would be crushing. I would say that would be very, very sad, knowing you leave that behind forever. And that's again what makes exploration to me is like to go out there experiencing all that with all the hardships that we endure, and then come back and then yeah, you can go back running into the forest and there you have it, and you will appreciate the beauty of our planet even more so.
Indeed, there's no other place like Earth. Maybe, I mean, people will find some other simulation, like you were saying, interesting missions that you have, so you are satisfied with your time there. But I would miss a lot Earth if I would know I would not get to see it again. Actually, talking now about this aspect of missing, there's one about being sick in space. Did you or any of your workmates got a fever or something, mild sickness out in space?
Yeah, it's entirely possible for humans to get sick also in space. It's one of the things that we learned is that actually space is not so difficult for us humans to live in because our body functions pretty much the same up there, but there's a few things that are different and they can make people sick. Like you see that if you don't exercise in space, your muscles, your bone disintegrates and you get sick that way. There's also an aspect that's not completely understood yet, that some astronauts have suffered from degradation of their vision, so they saw less well in space. That's not completely understood, that phenomenon, but there's other things that could happen. Of course, you could also end up having like an appendicitis up there. That's really something that we need to plan ahead for. Nobody got that yet up there, but you know, if more people fly to space, it's only a matter of time. So how do we deal with it? Right now on IHS, the approaches for everything that requires surgery, we just medevac people, we bring them back to Earth and then deal with it there. It's bad enough probably to do an emergency descent in a spacecraft at 5G when you have a ruptured appendix. So it's bad enough, but it's survivable. But what do we do when we go to the moon or Mars? We cannot just turn around. So we need to find solutions for that, meaning we need to find ways to do surgery in space or to really minimize the likelihood of anything happening. That is really something that is on our minds. Yeah,
it would be interesting to do a surgery in microgravity and not having everything floating out. Hopefully that will not happen, but yes, that's interesting to think about. Another aspect the viewers are curious is about sleep. So how restful is sleep in zero gravity?
Yeah, that's also a very individual thing. I noticed in my first mission, I did not sleep as well as I sleep on the ground, but good enough. I guess still would sort of go in my sleeping bag for 8 hours and try to sleep. And I noticed that I need probably a little bit less sleep in space. So maybe 7 hours or maybe 1 hour less. And then also one thing that contributed to that was that in my first mission, my sleeping bag was too short. I'm not sure how that ended up being too short, but the sleeping bag that I was supplied, I had to cut the top off. Like usually we have a hood that we can put over the head, and I had to cut that because otherwise my feet wouldn't fit in. And during my second mission, of course, I made sure that this was fine. And so I had the sleeping bag with a hood that I could put over my face. And I had a towel that I rolled up as a sort of a pillow on my side. And that way I could snuggle in my sleeping bag. And I don't know if that was the reason or a few other changes that we made. Like we changed the light from being less blue towards a more yellowish red at night and to work with the melatonin cycle, things like that. For some reason, I don't know why, I slept much better on my second mission. Maybe I just got used to the whole thing. And so there was no difference, really. I slept really well.
I'm sorry, I had to laugh. Imagine coding
the anecdote. Actually, that's funny. Is that on Earth, I roll around in my bed a lot, so I sleep on the side, on my stomach, on my back. And in space, I caught myself several times that I tried to turn onto my side in sleep because I was used to it, and I felt like, oh, now I should change my position. But of course, it doesn't work. It's funny, like I had to laugh about myself after realizing that I am floating, but I tried to turn on my side. It's just how, realizing how we humans are sort of used to some things, and then we just like do the same thing in space.
It's funny to imagine all of that. Yeah, it's, yeah, maybe you don't enjoy it in the middle of the night, but then when you think about it, it's actually a different experience. We would never think of that here on Earth. People are also asking about your personal time. Like, how did you spend it besides taking pictures, of course?
Yeah, we don't have much personal time because we work a lot on the experiments, on maintenance of the station. So we have about 1 hour per day, roughly, that we can sort of spend our way. And of course, I did look a lot down to Earth and took photos. But also, of course, I tried to keep contact with my friends and family. So I called them every day. I wrote emails every day. That way, I never felt like I was really far away, even though I left the planet. I still felt to be with them. And they felt a little bit like being with me, and that's important. Also going to be important on the way to Mars, even though there we cannot directly talk due to the signal delay. Like, we have to sort of switch over to video messaging, sending them forth and back. That is going to be challenging, but that is something that I enjoyed. And of course, also hanging out with my crewmates. We sometimes like did games, like trying to throw a ball through a parkour in weightlessness and this and that. Sometimes you do that on a Sunday afternoon where you have a little bit more time off. But we do work a lot up there, so personal time is at premium.
Oh, but it sounds like a lot of fun. So now everybody wants to go up there to enjoy it. Another question to follow up on this, it's do you get psychological support? Or maybe, I don't know if you need it or if it's given or has it given before. Do you have something similar to counseling or any other methodologies that are applied?
Yeah, it's a good question, and it's a service that the space agencies provide. So you have a mission psychologist, like just like you have a mission doctor, and you have a mission for somebody for everything that helps you out. You could also counsel with him. In general, it's actually quite good to talk to people from that profession, because they have a lot of resources on how to deal with like harsh environments, how to deal with potential conflicts in the crew and this and that. And if everybody sort of is trained in that and knowledgeable on that by like talking, by understanding the processes before a mission, you get along with your crewmates fantastically, because everybody sort of is aware of what could wear you down and how important it is to be tolerant and like to stay friends with your crewmates. And that worked really well for us. So we didn't need it as a sort of counseling, because we were like worn out or frustrated, but it's more like a positive resource that you can tap in once in a while when you think it's important. And that's great to have.
Indeed it is. I think also here on Earth would be important to have always someone to talk to and someone that will care about you. So that's good that you also have there in space. Talking about, before we were talking about Kurt Nikolaj, actually, that Swiss astronaut Kurt Nikolaj just gave a talk this afternoon as well. And he works at Swiss Space Center just down the hall from our office. And he's actually watching online. He's saying, "Hello, Alex, good to see you. Thanks for enriching the IGLUNA Fuel campaign with your experience and insight. What's next for you now, the moon?"
Hey, Claude. Yeah, good to talk to you, at least one way here. Just for the viewers, as a background, Claude and I know each other since a long time, and we're good friends. And I stayed for quite a while, actually, in Claude's house in Houston when I was training there. So we have good memories there. Yeah, as for your question, what's next? I'm still in the astronaut corps, of course, sort of on proficiency training for spaceflight. Right now, I'm not nominated, assigned to a mission because I just came back from one. But of course, every astronaut is dreaming to go to the moon, and we will go to the gateway, and then later on to the moon's surface. ESA has just signed a memorandum of understanding with NASA, agreeing that there will be flights to the gateway, which is sort of a base station, space station around the moon that is going to be built in the next years. And then from there, astronauts will go to the surface. The international cooperation is just forming. ESA is part of that, which is great. And so, of course, I would love to go there. And in a way, we are European astronauts are training for that. We do courses like CAVES and Pangaea, which are analog courses that are helping us to understand strange environments by training underground in caves or in the analog landscapes that are very similar to the moon. Actually, I was scheduled to go there this year to Pangaea. Unfortunately, it was canceled due to Corona. But we'll do that next year. So I'm training to go to the moon. Let's see if I'm going in the end. Of course, there's less flights than astronauts, so we'll have to find out. But we'll make sure that we're prepared. And also at the same time, I'll be working in the Netherlands at ESA's technology facility, ESTEC. I'll take up duty there towards the last quarter of this year, working to understand even more about the technology development of ESA, and also working on the future of ESA's presence in low Earth orbit when ISS is getting sort of old. Just to see if we have solutions on how to keep ISS up there longer, or new solutions to understand what the member states, the ESA member states, need as a requirement there, what the ideas are. And so I'm working in the strategy department to actually get that nailed down to a strategy that we can propose to the member states. Several options that we can propose to the member states in the next ministerial. So lots of interesting jobs for me right now.
That's good that you mentioned, because actually a couple of our viewers were asking, what is your job as an astronaut, but here on Earth? So now that you answered that, maybe as a last question, because we are running now out of time, is what advice would you give to the students? So some are wondering, what's the criteria that ESA is considering the most when selecting an astronaut? And if you are part of the next astronaut selection board, and general advice you would give on this topic to our viewers?
Yeah, well, again, a very good question, especially since the next astronaut selection might be coming up soon here from ESA. So it will pay out to look at ESA's website in the next months and year. I can only give advice, I guess, what worked for me becoming an astronaut is not to focus too much on it, on the goal of actually applying and then being selected, because there's so many people applying, of course. Statistically, the chances are low. But to me, what helped, I guess, is that I applied because I wanted to fulfill that dream of mine. I wanted to give it a chance to be able to say, hey, I tried to apply once. Maybe I got kicked out, but hey, I did something to give my dream a chance. And so I wasn't worried so much about it, but I saw it as a big adventure. And then that way, I guess I was pretty relaxed during the selection. And maybe that was key to being selected, because in the end, I couldn't believe it. I didn't think I had what it takes to become an astronaut. I thought they're all superhumans. And then ESA selected me, and I thought maybe they made a mistake. You really want me? And so I guess in hindsight, I just had the wrong image of what it takes to be an astronaut. And so what it does take is something that many, many of you have, is dedication to learn new things, being curious, to want to know more about technologies, about different aspects of spaceflight, to be out there, maybe also to like to be in extreme environments, to sort of be curious about these things. If you have all that, then please give it a try and apply. The problem for ESA also in the last selections was that we only had 16% of the applicants were women. And that is sad, because we know really well that women astronauts are just as good as men astronauts. There's no difference there, just as it is in engineering and science. But apparently women didn't think they should apply for some reason. So we really want to encourage young women to apply for the next selection. We really want to make sure in the end that we have half men, half women, a diverse team in the astronaut corps. And so please give it a head. Don't let anybody tell you that you're not good enough because you might be wearing glasses, or you have fillings in your teeth, or you didn't study this or that. That is not true. You have a chance, and that is really something that I want to give along. We really want you to apply, and I mean, for so many reasons, you're working on those fantastic projects already. You might as well do the next step. I'm pretty sure many of you have much, much higher chances to become an astronaut than you would actually think right now.
Oh, wow, that's really inspirational, and it's a great way to conclude this section. Thank you very much, Alexander. We're really very grateful for this opportunity to discuss with you, the IGLUNA students, the public, everybody watching. I'm sure they learned a lot with your experience as an ESA astronaut. And we would like to thank you and thank the viewers for watching, and invite all our viewers to our next session. So tomorrow, P11 Celestial Team will be doing a live stream about their business here in our YouTube channel at 16:30 Central European Time. And on Saturday, we'll continue at 13 hours Central European Time with the Space Award Ceremony, concluding on Sunday. So don't miss it. It's the last sessions of the IGLUNA Virtual Field Campaign. Thank you very much, everyone, for watching. Thank you, Alexander, again. Would you like to say some last words before we conclude?
Oh, of course. I wanted to say thanks again to all of you, the IGLUNA team and all the participants. Please go ahead and finalize those projects. I'm really looking forward to the results already. They look very promising. It is something that brings spaceflight to further, much further. Like, it's the next step. Without you, there wouldn't be any innovation. So really, that the things that you do are so important. Please go ahead, and I wish you all the best. Maybe I'll see a few of you as colleagues at ESA, maybe in the astronaut corps or in the engineering teams or in the science teams. In any case, I'm looking forward to it. All the best.
Thank you, Alexander. That would be fantastic. Thank you, everyone. Have a good evening and see you next time. Bye.